name's Emmanuel Schotepe. I'm a philosophy student here at the college. And who's there? So, per the current culture, one can't make any sort of speech without quoting a few people. It's got to be Angela Davis, right, or Jesus, right, or Drake, right? So, in the spirit of the latter, I want to, just acknowledge I got a really big team, right? So that means this forum couldn't have come to being without a few folks. I'd like to acknowledge them before moving on to housekeeping rules for the forum. So of course, thank you to our sponsors, the Wabash College English Department, Gender Studies, and Philosophy Department. Also, thank you to the Malcolm X Institute, Unidos por Sangre, and the Wabash Shout Organization. Thank you also to Director William Fisco. And finally, thank you to my brother, Alejandro Reyna, for helping me get through this, all the computer paperwork, and make sure, this event can be super dope for the labs. And so as Bell Hooks said in a New York Times interview last year, you cannot have a successful revolution without humor. And I firmly believe that. Humor makes revolutions possible. Humor also makes it possible to bear through this introduction, right? And with that, allow me to get into what sparked the organizing of this event. So last summer, I was hanging out with a few friends at a house party, and I found myself talking about freedom and what that means and looks like to people that never saw it before. How can you know something you don't know? And think Meno's clap back at Socrates, right, at ADD of the dialogue. It's a real conundrum, right? How can you know something that you never saw? How can you know something you don't know? Right, and so for us black folks, we often turn to the likes of Steve Biko or W.B. Du Bois, folks like that. But understanding freedom means understanding oppression, and understanding oppression means understanding a hegemonic structure, a sort of current that runs through, creates, and sustains our political, social, and economic orders, benefiting those at the top and oppressing and disadvantaging those at the bottom. Understanding the gender hegemony, we know that that's a structure with maleness or masculinity at the top and femaleness or femininity at the bottom. The racial hegemony, whiteness at the top, blackness at the bottom, class, wealthy capitalists at the top, poor and working class at the bottom. So freedom for black folks, in my opinion, alongside a myriad of other organizers and organizations in this current movement for black liberation, for black lives, cannot be achieved without centering and focusing on black women. And I'd add, poor black women, because all too often I think that we focus on the respectable Michelle Obama types, but don't ever focus on the sex workers, or on the domestic workers, or even the drug addicts. They're people too, right? And surely their lives matter just as much as a college graduate's life. Sex workers deserve to work in a safe space, a safe environment, just as much as doctors and lawyers and mechanics do. So we're here to listen to black womanists, feminist thinkers, theologians, bloggers, activists. What this means is that we'll have a moderated panel and a Q&A session at the end. With that being said, I'd like to introduce our moderator, Dr. Thomas, who's a history professor at the college, and she will introduce our panelists.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us this evening. I'd like us to give Emmanuel a hand because we know how hard it is. So I have the privilege of introducing our distinguished guests. We have one who's in transit, so she will be coming in a little bit later. But for now, we will start from left to right so that you all can identify for questions that I know you're so excited to ask. So let's start on the left. We have Kat Black, who is a transgender activist and YouTube vlogger from California joining us. She said she's never seen so much corn, right? Can understand that. Kat has been featured on BuzzFeed.com and various other news outlets, and she's also a children's illustrator by trade and a self-proclaimed thrift store addict. We have some of her co-sisters in here. Francina Turner is next, and Francina is a mother of three and a doctoral student in education policy, organization and leadership, concentrating on the history of higher education. She is also pursuing a graduate minor in gender and women's studies, where her work has focused on black masculinities and black feminisms. Francina holds an EDM in education policy, organization and leadership from the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign, and a BA in history from Fayetteville State University. She is also a member of Black Lives Matter, Champaign-Urbana, a co-founder of Students with Families, and a member of the Champaign Racial Justice Task Force. She is passionate about issues concerning black single mothers, and her current research focuses on counter-narratives of African-American women at co-educational HBCUs during the civil rights, black power, and black campus movements. Reverend Joanne Maria Terrell is a womanist theologian, an ordained minister in the African Methodist Episcopal Zion Church, and a professor at Chicago Theological Seminary. She received her PhD from Union Theological Seminary in New York City and is the author of the book Power in the Blood, The Cross and the African American Experience. Reverend Terrell's current research interests center around soteriological principles in Taoism, Buddhism, and Christianity, the genre of spiritual autobiography, and the power of the visual and performing arts to affect personal, social, and cosmic transformation. Paige May, who will be joining us later as soon as she drives in, is a queer feminist and prison abolitionist from Chicago. She is a founding member of Asada's Daughters, which is a grassroots intergenerational organizing collective of black women who love and support each other. She is also a member of BYP 100, an activist member-based organization of black 18 to 35-year-olds dedicated to creating justice and freedom for all black people, as well as a member of the organization We Charge Genocide, which is dedicated to stopping police violence, and she was one of the individuals chosen from that organization to go to Geneva, Switzerland, to present a report on police violence to the United Nations. After that experience, she returned to help organize for reparations for citizens who were victims of police torture at the hands of the Chicago PD, Police Department. Please join me in welcoming our distinguished guests.
Of color, and the name comes from the book In Search of Our Mother's Gardens by Alice Walker, where she coined the term womanist or womanism. Actually, she appropriated the term out of black culture, which had always used it to describe behavior that in young girls that was audacious, courageous, outrageous, serious, and in charge. And so many of us who were in the academy at the time she wrote this, or shortly thereafter, began to use this to name ourselves as womanists, distinct from feminists, because feminism historically had certainly the concerns of women of every culture in mind, but they rooted themselves in the experience of white women and did not count the experiences of black women as particularly of any importance to the elucidation of the doctrines that came out of feminism. And there was also concern about the image of God or goddess in white feminism that black women kind of reacted to because we didn't want to be worshiping a white goddess and or to have that be an implication of what we do. There are three other definitions in Alice Walker's example of what is a womanist, and they are, one is that A womanist is not a separatist except for health. A womanist loves women and men, sexually and or non-sexually. That particular definition caused some people in the religious academy to stumble because of their conservative convictions about human sexuality. But and it raised the question of whether or not you have to appropriate the whole definition of womanism in order to be a womanist. And I think that to define yourself is the major thing. You use the terminology the way you will to define yourself. And another definition is that a womanist is traditionally capable, as in, mama, I'm taking a bunch of slaves with me to Canada and I'm getting out of slavery. And mama says, it wouldn't be the first time that happened. So it's an example of the kinds of behavior that womanists, and I use the term proto-womanists to describe someone like Harriet Tubman or Sojourner Truth, because frankly, you could not expect them to embrace every definition of womanism that came about in the postmodern era. Another definition of womanism is that a womanist is, that womanist itself is to feminist as purple is to lavender. And another definition is that womanists love roundness, love food, loves the moon, and loves herself regardless. And for me, loving oneself regardless is the sine qua non of what it means to be a womanist, without which you could not be a womanist. And to go again to womanist is to feminist as purple is to lavender, suggests an intensified experience of oppression, so that race, class, and gender oppression and sexual oppression conflate. It's not as if you could separate those things out from each other and articulate a separate oppression. But they conflate in such a way to give the character of black women's oppression a particular image with which to associate. And so that's a very powerful image for me. And it certainly suggests, though, that the oppression that all women experience is on a continuum, and that we need to reflect very deeply about what it means for different women in different parts of the world. The other thing that womanists responded to, other than white feminism, was black theology in the religious academy. Black theology centered male experience as the paradigmatic experience of how to talk about black oppression. For example, if you think about the 1960s and 50s, when they were protesting and agitating for civil rights, many of the signs that people held up says, "I am a man." And many people meant that literally, in such a way, because black men have not had the affirmation of our culture in the way that other people have. And I won't say in the way that black women have. Black women have been, since the post-slavery workforce, been compelled to be a class of servants for whites. And so, and black men were precluded from that same class of servants, and given very restricted corridors for empowerment at all. And so so people meant that when they said, "I am a man." Even the women who held those signs meant that we want to affirm the men in our community. And so the idea that a womanist is not a separatist except for health suggests that we are willing to cooperate. We are willing to cooperate in the liberation of our people from all manner of oppression, but we need to recognize that the character of black women's oppression is unique, and it requires some unique visioning as to how to go about doing that.
So for me, my introduction to black feminism was really by way of
telling people what they already were telling me, right? So when you fight for particular things, I'm an activist. I'm not going to say an activist by trade, but it feels that way, right? And so when you fight for certain things, the common insult will be, oh God, you're a feminist, right? And so for me, there was a fight between feminism and womanism for me. I think that's almost an irrelevant fight now that I look back and think about it. But what was happening was that black men, guided by certain popular social media figures, were giving me permission to be a womanist. Like, you can be a womanist because womanists don't hate men, right? So I rejected that. So I think that I rejected womanism based on the fact that you're giving me permission to matter, right? I'm telling you I want to matter, you're going to tell me how to matter, right? So, I decided black feminism worked for me. It was a word that when I said it, it wasn't centering your feelings. Black women are never centered. So for me, that's why black feminism is what worked for me. Having said that, my feminism happened in an odd way. I didn't come to feminism academically. My trajectory through college, through higher education was it was a winding road. My feminism was within my own life first. Then I learned theory and history and all these different things, and I realized that my everyday actions were already feminist, right? I realized very early on that this rejection of what we're calling white feminism, which isn't just women who are white, there's a particular theory and history to that as well. But it pretty much only centers, as she said, it only centers the experiences of white women. And when it centers the experience of women who are not white, it's as if to say, oh shoot, we forgot those women who aren't white. And you'll throw one in for an issue that you haven't listened to those women. So the way my feminism works is that it's feminism with an S, because women, especially black women all over the world, have to experience and negotiate their feminisms in different ways. Their oppressions, while they're still oppression, are different. So there isn't like this essentialized, I don't believe in the essentialized oppression, that we all face the same kind of oppression. And the ways that we can enact agency within those oppressions operates differently in different locations. So there's that. Also, when it comes to how black feminism interacts with men, I'm over and I will never again explain that I don't hate men. I will never again explain that I don't hate men. I am a mother of sons and a daughter of a father that I love, and I'm never gonna address that again, right? So y'all, that last time, I'm never gonna address it. But the thing that makes us push, even when we know we'll be called divisive, even when we know that centering ourselves is not what you do, is because the way things have operated in the past, it's been not just that only black men matter, but that black men matter first. And I don't think that works. We have, in terms of the movement I'm active in, the Black Lives Matter movement, we see a marked difference in how the deaths of black women, of black trans women are treated in comparison to the way the deaths of black men are treated. That is something that we have to work through in our activism. We see very clearly that these movements are started and populated by black women, often black queer women, and when microphones come out, those women disappear, right? We see that in our activism. That's another thing that has to stop, because that's just a repetition of what already happened. So the reason we study history is so that we don't make the same mistakes again, right? But we are replicating them again. So like, my academic research looks at what happened in a particular college that allowed that very same thing to happen. The reason I'm interested in that is because it's happening now. We have instances in certain places where women do all the footwork, all the legwork, all the heavy lifting, and then a microphone comes out and we're physically pushed out of the way. We're not invited to decision-making meetings. I don't know if you guys are aware of the Fees Must Fall movement in South Africa, but the same thing is happening over there. So that's just a little bit about my feminism and how it's always, always tied to activism for me.
I would say that my feminism is very organic. It's very, it's constantly changing. For me, I think I had to kind of come to this point in my life where I recognized that, similar to what she said, that my actions are feminist. The things that I believe in are feminist. The things that I fight for are feminist. And for me personally, there are so many things that I am still trying to understand about all of my intersections. And as somebody who has a voice, particularly one that is growing and growing and growing, one of the things that I'm constantly facing that I'm baffled by is how people dismiss my words simply because I'm a black woman. I can have all of the sources they want, everything together. It could be formatted correctly, presented in a polite tone. But they still won't believe it. And that's something that is hard for me to swallow. That's something that is hard for me to understand. And so my feminism has been a lot about that, about how my voice and the voice of other black women within these activist circles are erased, are dismissed, are completely devalued. And that is something that has happened historically. That is something that has happened continuously. As a trans woman, there are a lot of things about womanity that are things that I've had to come to understand. I remember taking several feminist classes in school, and I think I thought at the time that they weren't going to really be that serious, right? But as I started to hear about the way that women have been factored into history, how I started to hear about how specifically black women and black women's bodies have been framed and dehumanized, I started to recognize how relevant it was to me. And so for me, my feminism is really about recognizing the fact that, you know, we all have intersectional existences and we all face very specific issues. And there's not a problem with discussing those issues. There's not a problem with saying that because I'm a black woman, what I'm going to face is going to be different from what a white woman is going to face. And I'm somebody who believes that there can be really productive conversations, but I'm constantly frustrated by the fact that those conversations are never really listened to. So I'm somebody who, I could almost argue that, you know, there's a conversation between womanism and feminism, and I've thought very much, even in this conversation, which label, but I don't know if that's necessarily important to me. I don't know if it's as important to me to say that I'm here or there. I personally believe that the issues are more important, which is why I love having fellowship with black feminists and black womanists, because it doesn't really matter. We're all talking about the same thing. We're all fighting towards the same end and the same goal. And personally, what I'm going through right now in my life is my voice is being, you know, there are a lot of people who don't listen, but there's a lot of people who are listening. And I'm recognizing that there's a lot of change that I can bring by simply being a visible black trans woman. I was recently featured on like the YouTube Democratic debate, and someone mentioned to me like how like it's kind of groundbreaking that, you know, that a black woman's being listened to this, but a black trans woman is being listened to in these conversations. And so I kind of recognize the responsibility that I have in order to forward those conversations. And I think for me, what really made me feel like these conversations were necessary was seeing the Black Lives Matter movement, was seeing things like Trayvon Martin happen, and to see how many people in my life really communicates to me in so many ways that they don't care about black lives. And, you know, I grew up, you know, in a situation where there weren't a lot of white people, but there were not any black people. And so I had this very, we are the world, we can all be, you know, we can all da 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 da. And in the past 3-4 years, I've recognized, wow, these issues are real. So I'm constantly in the state of educating myself and through the process, educating people around me. So I try to use my platform and my feminism to spread that understanding, to give historical context, really, to a lot of the things that we're discussing, to give context to why it is that we live in a society where we even have to say that Black Lives Matter. You know, there's a reason for that, and the reason for that is because from not even that long, Black people have been able to have autonomy over their bodies. People don't necessarily get that it hasn't really been that long. So I think that, you know, I view my feminism as something that's constantly trying to point out intersections and educate, and also for me to be educated, so.
Can you guys talk a little bit or respond to those who suggest that womanism, feminism are simply another way to divide us at a time when women clearly have made progress, right? We're CEOs, professors, we are coaching pro sports teams. How does womanism, feminism help unite a country at a time when we're clearly progressing, right? And it actually seems to further divide us into other categories.
For me, that question is interesting because when we have man-only decision-making bodies, nobody questions why it's only men. So it's universalized that that's possible and that's okay. So for me, we have progress, but that progress is being gendered, right? So yes, like we're still saying in 2016, the first woman too, right? We're still saying that. This election season is so, I say that I've never needed Pepto-Bismol more. And so, I don't even have the words for it, right? And so, the ways that we can use gender against women and then ask why gender matters confuses me. And though it doesn't confuse me, I just think it's funny. So, in terms of division, I kind of feel like if you come over to feminism, we wouldn't be divided. Right. So for me, within feminism, when Emmanuel was talking about how can you imagine a thing that you have never had, for me, freedom is something other than this, right? It's the ability to imagine something other than this. And I think within feminism, it allows so many open doors to do that. So for me, it's not my feminism that's dividing us, it's your rejection of my feminism that divides us. And my just declaration, kind of unapologetically, we talk about Black girl magic, just unapologetically that I matter, if that divides us, we should be divided. We should be divided if me asserting that I matter is divisive.
And it's very shocking to see that when Black women come together and say, you know what, I'm beautiful, Black is beautiful. It's interesting to see how people who have always benefited from the narrative of white supremacy respond to that. Why is it threatening that Black girls are saying that we're beautiful? Why is that challenging to you? And how can you argue with me that you're interested in equality and you're so much more invested in these, you know, conversations that are productive when me saying that Black women are beautiful is somehow offensive to you, is somehow a sign of division to you? To me, I think that the problem we often have is people use the buzzword of equality. Equality for so many people is this empty term that really doesn't mean anything. It's this thing that people say and they don't necessarily, I don't think, mean it. For me, I'm more invested in equity and justice. I believe that people need to recognize that, you know, there are inequalities in this world. I can't even believe that we could, you know, go towards a point where we're fighting for equality when we're not recognizing how we are unequal. And to me, when people say that we're dividing, that's communicating to me that you're not interested in listening to those differences. You're not interested in listening to how we are already divided. Because I feel like with more empathy, with more conversations, that maybe we can become together. Maybe we can all, you know, work and live in this happy post-racial, post-sexist, you know, society that we want to live in. But we're not there yet. You know, one thing I always hear on my page is, you're a first-world woman sitting on your computer, da 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 da. Sure, you know, things could be worse for me, yes. But that doesn't mean that they're still where they need to be, you know. It's frustrating because sometimes it sounds like they're saying, well, at least you're not getting raped every day.
That's exactly what they're saying.
And they're ignoring the fact that that's happening, that rape is happening. You know, why should I accept what it is just because it could be so much worse, right? I think that people need to just listen to these conversations and understand that we all have different experiences, and that's completely okay. It's okay to say that we all have different experiences. It's okay to acknowledge that we all have different experiences. And I think if we listen to each other and empathize with each other a little bit more, things could really go somewhere. Imagine where we could be if people tried to do that more often.
I think that Alice Walker tried to anticipate some of that question in her very definition of a womanist as a black feminist or a feminist of color, and offers womanist really as a nuance on the whole feminist conversation. But I come at that whole question from the perspective of a theologian. And what our real beliefs and our actions translate into in terms of how we create relationships at all. And so in 2004, I wrote an article for the Union Seminary Quarterly Review in for a fest trip honoring Dolores Williams, one of the founders of Womanism. And the article is called A 10-Point Platform for a Womanist Agenda, or What Womanists Want. And the first thing that I wrote was the vigorous promotion of the idea that African women and women of the African diaspora, black women, bear as fully as all other persons the image and imprimatur of divine reality. And I wrote that because for many people, our imagination cannot extend to the recognition of the divine in black women. It cannot even extend to that point, or the recognition that black people at all bear the image and imprimatur of divine reality. But I want to say that that first one says, in essence, black women's lives matter because they are so invisibilized in this culture that does not warrant that black women are the standard of anything. Not the standard of beauty, not the standard of intellect, not the standard of anything except caregiving. And so to raise the question as a theologian would, I say that black women, we need to honor in black women as womanists the image and imprimatur of divine reality. So and so I'm not convinced that there's a fight between feminism and womanism at all. Because, as I said, Alice Walker is trying to anticipate that. And then those of us who know that there is a difference in the character of black women's oppression. There's a very huge difference. For example, every 5 minutes a woman is raped, yet black women are 3 times as likely to be the victim of rape. 3 times as likely. We know that in the history of this country, where rape is a capital or was a capital offense, that no one has been executed for raping a woman except a black man. So there's a huge difference in the way that relationship gets made, that the religious imagination gets shaped by the way we use language, and that's why I continue to use the language, and that's why the promotion of the idea that black women bear as fully as all other persons, it also means that all lives matter. It just, and I think that saying black lives matter assumes that all lives matter. It assumes that, and people don't have enough religious imagination to say, oh, it's incorporated. But we have to say this because it's not apparent to everybody. We have to say that black women bear the divine image because that's not apparent to everybody. I've been called everything in the context of classroom. I've been called out for teaching because I'm a woman. I've been called out and called a castrating matriarch in the classroom. I've been called some of everything in the classroom. And I'm none of those things. I had to let a young man know it was not me or anybody who looked like me that strung black men up in trees and murdered them. I had to tell someone just a week ago that it's not the Black Lives Matter movement that's killing young black men in the streets and saying, because they said to me, if all black lives matter, then why aren't they protesting black on black crime? Well, it's not Black Lives Matter movement that's killing black people. Just so we need to be very clear about how to ascribe motives, motivation, and also image. The image in our minds have to be shaped by a different theology. So,
I want to address something. It might come up as another question, but I'm not sure, so I'm going to address it now. There are also ways that the divisiveness question, it just erases black women completely. So we've all heard of the book, All the Women Were White, All the Men Were Black, and Some of Us Were Brave. So a lot of these conversations, you brought up specifically rape as an example. In that conversation, black women disappear. Because we know the historical, we know the history of black men and white women and as it relates to rape. So because of that, their specific history, if we're raped, because of the fact that anything we do is considered divisive, anything other than maybe it's going to be okay, is divisive. When we are raped, who do we tell, right? If we say something about rape and we call the police, that's us trying to put a black man into the white system. And so we know that the numbers with which we're raped, the numbers with which black trans women are raped are astronomical, but we're conditioned from birth not to say anything. So we have family histories of molestation and rape where these girls are not supposed to be saying anything. And to me, when I hear that we're being divisive, that's one of the main things I hear. Like, I'm supposed to shut up about my pain so that we can look unified. But how about we just be unified, right? Why should I have to look like we're unified? And again, I haven't killed any black men in the church, right? But we get punished for it in a very particular kind of way. We do a lot of the heavy lifting, is what I call it. We do a lot of helping you feel better. We do a lot of taking the anger when it's not us that did it, you're mad at something outside of us, and we take that, and we're supposed to continuously to do that, kind of generation after generation, or we're being divisive. So to me, the divisiveness question is never honest. Mm-hmm. It's never coming from an honest place.
The irony isn't lost that at a womanism, feminism forum that I began my question to you guys, right? All male school. Wabash is an all-male college, and so I expect that there are people listening to you speak and think, that's really interesting, right? But what does this have to do with me, right? I'm neither a woman, and in many cases, I'm not a person of color. What does any of this have to do with me? How would you respond to that?
So that's very interesting because Mother Bell Hooks says, one of the things she said in Feminism is for Everybody, which sparked any research I've done in black masculinity, is that if we had ever, meaning the people who kind of were the progenitors of putting this black feminism thing on paper, if we had taken the time to create for black men, and if we'd imagined a place for black men outside of this kind of white supremacist patriarchal myth, if we'd done that work, nobody would ever be able to convince them that we hate them, right? If you read any Bell Hooks books, there's just so much love for black men in every single one of her books. So to me, she's a good jumping point, the start-off point, if you want to read about it. But so for me, that made me do a research paper where I interviewed 7 black men who I thought had feminist politics. And really what that meant at the beginning of the paper was just that they weren't horrible, right? And so it didn't take a lot for me to say you have feminist politics at the time, right? And so, of course, through the paper, I find out that some of them really don't, right? We know, those of us who know what feminist politics are, some of them didn't. But at the end of the day, one of the most important questions I asked them was, what would a world without patriarchy look like? Yeah. So it's 2 questions. One, what's been your interaction with feminism? And 2, what would a world without patriarchy look like? Some of them could not imagine a world without patriarchy. They didn't have an answer. One of them said, and it was a recorded, it was a voice-to-voice interview. One of them said, it would be free, right? And I almost tear up thinking about it, because if you could have heard the inflection in his voice, when he was like, I would be free, right? So I think that men now, I think we always have understood how much pressure patriarchy is for men. So my enemy is not men, my enemy is patriarchy. And if we could imagine a world without the necessity for domination and murder and mayhem and all the things that that patriarchy needs in terms of control, right? If we can imagine a world without that, and I think feminism allows us room to do that. So I think it's useful not just for women, not just for black women, but I think it's useful for everybody. What black feminism does and womanism, what they do is allow you to look at the world a different way. It insists that you look at the world a different way. So we think about all the things that affect women, the ways our bodies are objectified, just all kinds of different things. But if I look at body objectification, y'all getting objectified too, right? There's a certain way, a masculine way, that you have to look. There are all these different things that if you don't embody that, that has to feel like pressure. And so what I feel is that the usefulness of black feminism at the smallest level to men and even to people who aren't even black is it allows you freedom to kind of imagine yourself as you could be without something as oppressive as patriarchy.
And I think that we should all kind of recognize that we live in a society that pushes certain ideologies into us from day one. You know, a lot of what I think men and everyone honestly need to do is recognize that there are certain societal biases that are embedded in us. We are socialized with them, and so, you know, when she says that there are men who don't have the ability to imagine a world without patriarchy, that's a great example, because we are so accustomed to and so conditioned to seeing that as the only way. You know, one of the common arguments that I get with men who are anti-feminists are they talk about how they're often placed into situations where they have dangerous jobs, how they talk about how violence is something that overwhelmingly affects them. And for me, when I hear that, I say to myself, well, why does that happen? Why is it that men are more often on the receiving end of violence? And it's because violence is often a tool of masculinity. Violence is often how men, boys, learn that this is how you are to be a man in this world. You are to be authoritative, violent, etc. We hand girls dolls, we hand boys swords, and they hit each other with them. And whoever wins is the man of the house. You know, I think that those are very important things to think about. I think those are very important things to digest and just recognize that that is something that is encouraged, and it's also something that is celebrated. It's rewarded in our society. And we see the damage that that does to men. We see how men are often on the receiving end of violence. And I think that it's worth digesting and also breaking that down.
And then I would ask every person, well, what is your purpose? You know, and that has to be everybody's question, every individual's question. What is my purpose in life? Is my purpose to hurt and harm, or is my purpose to establish mutual and right relationships with every person I encounter? Is that part of my religious thinking? Is that part of my social thinking? And how do I go about doing that? And how do I go about improving my own and my children's chances for survival and quality of life that's different from the quality of life we're living now as estranged persons? And that estrangement has a deep cost to our own humanity and our spirituality and our truth. There's a deep cost to that when we prefer that to what can happen in genuine relationship, in authentic relationship, in authentically learning the ways of love, and as a, not just as an interpersonal thing, but as a as a means to achieve a just society. So you have to continuously ask, what is my purpose, and how do I achieve that with a better frames of reference than the ones that are provided for me, that often lead to violence, that often lead to more and more estrangement, and the presumption of privilege that you don't deserve, that no one deserves. So I just ask you to think about it in that way.
We're going to take a brief pause and say hello to our guest, Paige May, if we'll give her a hand. But if you want to take a moment to maybe talk about a little bit about what feminism and or womanism means to you and how it informs your activism.
Yeah. So I first want to say I'm very, very sorry that I was an hour late. It was mostly just me being foolish and not realizing we were in a different time zone. I'm from Vermont, it's East Coast time, in Chicago now though, and I also had a bit of a family emergency, so I apologize. My name is Paige May. I'm an organizer with, at this point in time, I'm a co-founder of Asada's Daughters, which is an intergenerational grassroots collective of black women and girls who work to love and support each other. And I'm also a member of BYP 100, Black Youth Project 100, which is a collective of 18 to 35-year-old black identified folks who do direct action and policy work to get free. And I also got really kicked off into organizing through a group called We Charge Genocide, an effort called We Charge Genocide, which actually went to the United Nations. And all of those projects that I'm a part of are rooted in a black queer feminist tradition and are explicitly follow a black queer feminist framework. However, each one of those groups is different. We Charge Genocide was interracial, intergenerational, all genders were welcome, but BYP 100 is 18 to 35-year-old black identified folks, and then Asada's Daughters is explicitly for black women and femme identified folks. But all of those things are black queer feminists. So to me, it doesn't necessarily, there's a difference between my identity as a black woman, as a black queer woman, and my politics of black queer feminism. And there's a lot of overlap, and I think absolutely my identity informs my politics. But first and foremost, right, why I think feminism, particularly black queer feminism, is so important to the work that I do is because it comes out of the reality that who is harmed and who we show up for are not always the same. And who does the work and who gets the credit is not always the same. And until that, those are the same, we have to center the folks that are erased, that are invisibilized, that whose suffering and struggles aren't appreciated. And that's just like, first and foremost, I don't know how else to say it, right? I have organized so many actions, so many events for black men that are killed by the police, and I can get 1,000 people to turn out. If I do it for a black woman, 100 of almost only black women, right? So I see it, it is real, it is palpable. There's also something that I think is also tangible, but it gets more abstract. And this is the realities of like, you know, even, you know, where it moves beyond my identity and my love of black women and my love of black queer people, is that black people, even black cisgendered men, non-transgendered men, suffer because of sexism, right? And I say specifically, right, black people. And this is the ways that race has been constructed, and anti-blackness has constructed blackness in particularly, uses gender and uses sexuality, right? Where you have, during slavery, black people are considered the lady of the races. And so of course, right, given the sexism that's deeply rooted in society, the response from black male leadership is not like I am a man, not I am a person, but I am a man. And that's because of the ways that our anti-blackness uses gender to really, really push black people down, right? And so when that, we see time and time again, if we study social movements, we see the limitations of that thought, that idea that we will get free, that black men can use, can only be made visible, can only be made only be made respectable if they follow the rules of oppressing women, if they follow the rules of oppressing queer people. That's a version of assimilation that I'm not down for, because that's not how we're going to get free, Right? We have to understand the ways that gender, sexuality, and race and class all connect and intersect and overlap. And at the same time, this is what ends up making people uncomfortable. That means along the way, we have to center Black queer women, Black femmes, and Black women. And it doesn't mean that we're trying to say Black men don't struggle, that Black men don't have real problems, but that there, first of all, there's just no evidence that centering Black men is going to get us free. And secondly, the reality is that racism is deeply, not only connected, but is grounded, is fundamentally attached to sexism. And so feminism has to be a part of anti-racism. You cannot separate them. You can't. It won't work. So I'll pause there.
Well, I'm going to kind of build off of some of the things you said, and I'm curious for the panel in general. What role do you see feminism and womanism playing in our current social, political movements, like Black Lives Matter, like police shootings, like prison reform, like trans rights? What role does feminism and womanism play in the cultural context of what's going on now?
I'm not sure I understand the question. Does you mean feminism or feminists, or the concept?
Right. I would argue both. In movements that are largely gender, or at least in terms of how they're portrayed, perhaps media portrayals, male, right? Mm-hmm. All of these movements are largely gendered male, and how we perceive them, how we see them. what role do feminists play in that, and what role does feminism and womanism play?
So for me, my activism and my feminism are married, right? They merge together and there's no separating. So for example, there's a lot of work done in my town, in Champaign, there's a lot of work done around prison justice and reacclimating those who are released from prison back into the community. But what they notice right off is that if one man goes to prison, an entire family is affected, right? So the ways that Black men, first of all, they don't work off the assumption that it's only Black men who are in prison. That's not what they focus on. But if you're focusing on it, if you're looking at the Black men who are in prison, it affects the economic stability of the whole family, not just because he's an income source gone, but it costs so much money for somebody to be in prison, right? Families, children, his wife, his mother, all these people suffer. And so I'm really impressed with how they look at that from a whole community standpoint, and that's a very feminist standpoint to look at it from. I also look at how, in dealing with activism, how you center the voices of the people affected, and you just don't work. So it works when it works from the bottom up. To me, that's a very feminist way of looking at it. You don't just, come in and decide you're going to be an activist and never ask the community what they need, that kind of thing. As Paige said, we need to be talking about the people affected. So one of the things that we're not allowed to talk about, for example, is how even outside of murders that have state-sanctioned murders of Black people by the police, outside of that, when women are like gunned down for not responding well to being catcalled, we can't talk about that, right? So these women are being murdered for that reason. We can't talk about trans women being murdered. These are things that we can't talk about. But I would argue that those are also state-sanctioned murders. Right? And so feminism, I think, allows us to step back and look at how all of this is intertwined, all of it matters, that the people on the ground know things, right? That we're never going to get free by kind of just sprinkling down some of our academic awesomeness on these people. And I think sometimes we want to do that, right? We learn, because a lot of us, our educations are so tied to our communities, right? We want to go get an education and come back and help. But you also can't, I can't not talk to the people where it's happening. I can't, even if I'm removed because I'm here in school, I stay very connected to the people that I'm fighting for. And I'm never fighting for them. I don't ever know they struggle so hard that I can fight for them without talking to them. So I think that that's some of the ways that feminism ties in.
I think that that women politicians are walking gingerly around the issues of pushback from the society, from the the patriarchal Congress. They're walking too gingerly around the ravaging of Planned Parenthood, mm-hmm. and just because if you push back too much, you get the backlash. And I think that's a real issue for folk. And you won't get the vote if you speak too forcefully about things that matter. But I think it does provide for other women a platform for their activism. And I'm happy about that. But I think that the ones who already are empowered are afraid of being even further disempowered by if they speak too much. So I think that feminism plays a role in terms of people just knowing what the issues are, but unable to parlay that into much more of a powerful voice on behalf of women, because they're afraid of losing what power they have.
I think for me, I'm 27. I've only been organizing really for a few years, so my perspective is quite limited. But my understanding is that, right, feminism has, women, I'll just say that, so women have been like critical, like the backbone to every movement that I have ever studied. That is not new, right? But they don't get the credit for it. That is also not new. And we're seeing the same thing now, right? It's a very similar struggle. At the same time, my sense of things from getting to talk to folks like Angela Davis and get to talk to folks who have talked to like people who were in the guard, who were in the 1920s, right? Organizing the Black Lives Matter movement is different and is an evolution of our struggle. And I don't think of social movements as like they happen and they end and then new problems happen. I see a continuation, and it's the same struggle, and each side is learning. The freedom side is learning, and our oppressor is learning. So I think there is a kind of respect and centering of feminism that is different and is exciting and is important. And I think what's really exciting about it, I know for me, I just enjoy it because it helps me be more healthy in the work. To have my role and my identity and be recognized and appreciated and censored. But that the fact that you have feminism being centered at the same time that you have this kind of rejection of respectability politics, I think that's really cool to me. Right, so you like an example of this is like the difference is like Beyonce performing at that formation at the Super Bowl would not have been seen as feminism, I don't think, like 20 years ago. Because it rejected respectability politics. If you compare like Beyonce to like the women in Gardneyism, right? Like, their long white robes, very conservative, right? Like they're both a part of feminism, and I have mad respect for the women who were a part of the Garvey, who are still a part of Garveyism. But I think that it does follow along respectability politics. Same thing with like the civil rights movement. So what we're seeing now, I think that's what's really promising to me is that. Right, I am able to show up in spaces and have the fact that I'm a woman be honored, but in ways that don't like narrow what it means to be a woman, and that I have to like be like fragile and like cry a lot. Like that's not how I am at all. Like and that's okay. Like, I can cuss. I can dress however I want. And that is in part actually like what makes me more powerful is that I grind against the status quo in more ways than one when it comes to how I am a woman. Not just that I am a woman, but how I am one.
I don't have the best, like, most succinct answer to this, but I will say that one thing I've noticed is that feminism is a conversation now. We're talking about it. And from my audience, it tends to be, you know, pretty young. And I get so many emails from, like, 14-year-old girls that are like, you've inspired me, you've empowered me, you've encouraged me. And to me, that's amazing, because I see that translating into change down the line. I think that these conversations being looked at, these conversations being had, is empowering to women overall. And I love that that's kind of a shift that I'm seeing right now, is that these conversations are seeping into the mainstream. These conversations are being had. there's also, you know, there's always a criticism that comes with that mainstream aid. But I'm glad that it's happening, and I'm glad that I'm seeing so many women speak up and also drop the I need to be this type of woman who speaks this type of way in order to be respected.
I'm going to ask one final question and then I'm going to open it up to the audience. The term get us free was stated, and I'm curious if all of you can kind of address what that means.
But first thing I want to say is I don't know exactly what the world that I'm fighting for looks like, but that's okay, and I don't have to know. Well, everyone should understand the world we have right now is not working, and that should be enough, right? And that we know it's not working and that it can be better. So having said that, I have some theories. So I understand, I'm in a place right now trying to understand what I get very frustrated with the ways that oppression gets flattened and made to be like, that the only way that we can recognize people struggling and the only way that we can show up in solidarity is if we recognize exactly what it is that's happening. And that's a big problem because it means that we only sympathize, that solidarity comes to mean that is you experience the same thing as me. And that's part of the problem, is this idea of that there's sane, that there's normal, that that's actually what leads to our oppression and domination, is the idea of normal, the idea of sameness. And we need to build a world big enough that allows for difference to exist without it causing differences in power. Within that, right, I believe that anti-blackness is real. And I believe that white supremacy is real. But if you look at the history of anti-blackness, it actually predates white supremacy. And so what that means then is, what does that mean? What is the difference between anti-blackness and racism? And so I'm really informed by a woman named Andrea Smith, who's an indigenous woman. And she has a theory of the three pillars of white supremacy. And it doesn't account for the ways that anti-blackness actually predates white supremacy. But I do understand, right, that right now we live in a world where indigenous people experience genocide. They are eliminated, either physically through massacre or through, right now, indigenous people still exist, but we always refer to them as if they are in the past, right? There are huge social movements of indigenous people in the United States and across the world. And the fact that we can't even like say their names, that actually the people most likely to be killed by the police are indigenous people, is an example of the difference between anti-black police violence and indigenous police violence. One is a project of genocide. It's about erasure and silencing. One is about social death, which is about the hypervisibility of black death. And that is why our deaths as black people can go viral, right? In ways that they're actually just feeding the system. It's supposed to go viral. It's why I'm so opposed to all these videos getting released, especially when it's when the family doesn't want it. So for me, when I think about what it means for black people to get free, it means the death of the slave. I don't think that I live on a plantation in the same way that like Nat Turner did. I know that. I'm here at a college that was probably founded by a white person, like talking to a mixed race group of people. That's beautiful. Slaves would not have been able to do that. I know. I'm not a Mormon. However, at the same time, I do think that all races have been enslaved, but black people are the only that blackness is born when you are a slave because you are black. All other people have been enslaved because they want your land, because you crossed a border, because you lost a war. Black people, beginning with the Arabic slave trade, not the transatlantic slave trade, are the first peoples, and it's born in dungeons, not in Africa, it's born in slave ships, not in Africa, are the first people to be like, you are black and thus you are a slave. And when you are a slave, it means that you experience dishonor. Everybody, what is it? Everybody wants to be a nigga, but nobody wants to be a nigga, right? Like, everybody wants to be black, but nobody wants to be black. Right? That's that dishonor that comes with being black. The idea of like you come from nowhere. You have no heritage, no history, right? Your ancestry is denied, and at both backwards and also forwards, meaning that you don't have control over your own children. Whether that be they get sold off of the plantation, or they get taken from you through the foster care system, or whether it be they get taken from you by the police. So there's that, and then the third is just naked violence. right? And I think stop and frisk is a great example of this, actually, more than police killings. But the idea that just for being black, you walk down the street and you have to be stopped and searched, and that's a euphemism. Being stopped and searched, I don't know how many of you have been stopped and searched, it's humiliating, right? It lasts a long time. You get called horrible names, right? I heard like murmurs when he's the N-word, like you get called an N-word all the time, right? And it leads to a lot of physical and verbal assault. And that's an example of naked violence. And that condition, is what defines slavery. And black people are the only people that experience solely because they are black. Nobody wants anything from us. They're not trying to get rid of us. They're not trying to get our land. It's just because we're black. And that needs to go. That condition, it's called social death, that's what needs to be eliminated. And then I think black people will be free. But that does nothing for the indigenous person who's experienced genocide. And so I don't know what that means to be a black person on a land I was kidnapped and put here, right? I don't know what that means for the native person whose land that I'm on. I don't know. But I don't think I have to. I think it's up to all of us to figure that out and to center the voices of those who are most affected. And I was not affected by colonization in that way.
So I would have to agree with Paige. I don't know what free looks like. I have no idea. But I do know that I have a great imagination. And I'm happy to spend time trying to figure out something different than this. And also, I think that I also agree with Paige that we don't really have to know, but everything that we see, there was a time when it wasn't this, right? So even the demon spawn of capitalism, right, there was a time when there wasn't capitalism. Somebody had to imagine that. And so I think that if we can imagine this and we've essentialized it to where it's normal, then we can imagine something else. I don't know what that is yet. I'm not quite sure what it looks like. But to me, freedom is something other than what we're experiencing. So when people in my family die, I don't say rest in peace, I say rest in freedom. Because they're able, regardless of what's on the other side, to be something different or somewhere different than this.
I absolutely agree with everything that's been said, honestly. I feel like everything that I might have said has been already said. But I will say that to me, freedom looks like being able to determine your own destiny, not having to be held back by what people think you are, how people perceive you to be who you are without that requirement to maintain who you were told you were yesterday. That's freedom to me. And I think that that applies to so many groups. So I think that's what freedom is, and that's my answer.
And I concur with everything that's been said and believe that it will require a complete revolution in consciousness and a commitment to living consciously and aware and capable of seeing with our two eyes and hearing with our two ears and engaging with all of our senses and our expression. Everyone as having something of the divine within them that teaches and that blesses and that informs what freedom is and what beauty is and to be able to enjoy that and to enjoy life, the gorgeousness of creation, the absolute gorgeousness of creation, that would be freedom to me.
Thank you. So we'll open it up. We have a little bit for questions. That's my question.
I have a question. I'm thinking about the young men that go to school here and my students. What is one just sort of like tangible thing that they could do in their everyday life to move us towards freedom or to move us towards a world that is more concerned with equity, as you all see it?
Listen. That's what I always say, just listen, you know? It's hard. It's hard to listen and also be an active listener, but listen. You know, because like we've said earlier, a lot of times we speak but people don't hear, or they dismiss, or they say, you have no right to say. And so I think the most important thing that men, all men, can do is listen.
One of the things that college is supposed to do for us is to to prepare us to further our purpose and also to take our place in the scheme of things as they exist. And so I think that one thing that each young man can do is reframe your purpose so that it is much more inclusive, so that it is much more free, so that it is much more conscious of what it is you can do to be useful to an agenda of liberation for the whole earth.
So I think headbutting that we do is because we believe in a shortage way of looking at things. Like there's a shortage of stuff you can get, and so that if we look at it different from that, then you don't have to look at a woman wanting to matter or wanting to exist within herself as taking something from you, right? And so to me, if we can just kind of recognize that it's a big planet, right? And just the ability to have agency over yourself is not a hit on you, right? So I think coupled with listening, coupled with purpose, just that this kind of idea of entitlement to space, give up some of the space. And I think that goes with listen, just like I'm trying to say it as clearly as I can, but just we're not at war with you. It doesn't even make sense, right? And so just like you love your sister, you respect your sister, you love and respect your mother, I look for commonalities, and I see them sometimes in some of the most horrible people, that we have more in common than you think, but we can't get past it because either it's you or it's me or whatever. But at the end of the day, stop fighting for space. Don't fight us for that. Like to me, that's unnecessary.
Yeah. Something that I do as someone who's like not from Chicago, who's really light, who has a lot of privilege in spaces that I'm in, is I try to let three people talk before me, before I speak. And I try to only speak twice. So just things like that, like count how many times are you speaking and how long. There's something called mansplaining. This is really annoying. You can Google. The other thing is just Google it. If you're confused, you have an interaction and you're like, that was weird, I got called sexist. I bet the internet has something to say about it. So mansplaining is like, don't assume that it means that if you weren't asked a question, like what do you mean? I don't need to know what you mean. I'm a smart person. I know. I probably know the answer. I might know more than you, actually. Maybe you should ask me. That's like, I used to go to schools and do climate education for high schoolers, like climate science. And the number of times where people assumed I was the assistant, because I'm black and I'm young and I'm a woman, was horrible. Like, I would get left in the lobby for half an hour. There's also something called manspreading. That's also annoying. I look in the aisle right now and count how many men have their legs wide open and how many women have their legs crossed. And then notice that on things like trains and in other places. So just be conscious. Just every now and then check yourself and be like, literally how much am I talking? Literally how much space am I taking up? Literally where did I choose to sit myself in this restaurant? You'll see, it'll be a line of men on one side and a line of women on the other, and they're protected. It's everywhere. And so for me, the biggest thing is just admit that we're all kind of effed up. Just admit it. Don't say it out loud. Admit it to yourself and work on it. Read, practice, debrief, reflect, and do better. Everyone can do better. Like, I don't care that you be perfect. I care that you not be insistent that, no, I'm right. I'm a good ally because I know the word ally. So.
Okay. Hi. Hi, I'm Nathan. I'm a senior political theory major. I'm really interested in state education, and it's no surprise that state-based education really pushes a lot of these constructs, ideologies, things that contribute to why we're having this discussion at all. So I'd love to hear your thoughts on how you see state-based education coming into play with the future of these movements.
Well, I personally think that, like, one of the things that I've been doing right now on my channel is, you know, every time Black History Month comes around, we hear, well, what about white history? And so I've been doing a series on my channel about white history, you know? And what it really reality is it's not like a lot of people, they always think I hate white people. They always think I hate white people. So they think it's like I'm trying to attack white people. But really what I'm talking about are some things about whiteness as a construct in this country that we have never discussed, you know? And when you don't know these things, it's so easy to just think that, oh, well, you know, I learned that, you know, Abraham Lincoln freed the slaves and then racism is over, like, you know, because that's what we're taught. And I think that what people don't get, and this is what I had to realize after my education, is that a lot of the way that education is constructed, specifically history education, is constructed to breed patriotism. It's constructed to say, isn't America a great country, you know? And this country is great in many ways, but it's also terrible in so many. And so many people have been hurt because of things that have happened. And there are still existing things that exist today because of what happened. Like one of my videos was all about Chicago. You know, there's so much history in Chicago with immigration and assimilation into whiteness and the exclusion of black people that you wouldn't ever know unless you looked for it. You're not gonna learn this in your school. You're not gonna learn it, you know? When I found out about Takeo Ozawa in my college, that there was a time where you would actually go to court to argue that you were white enough to be able to have certain rights, that blew my mind. That blew my mind that that was a reality in this country. So I think that what I would like to see is just more honest education and recognize that, yes, this is dark history, but we can do better, move beyond it, and move past it. But I think so often, the thing that I run into whenever I'm having conversations, arguments, debates, whatever, with people is that they just don't know. And that's why I try to operate from a position of, you know, maybe you're just being an ass, but maybe you just don't know. So here's the information, here are some sources, do with it what you will. But what I love about my series is I'm literally just saying history, and it happened, and we need to acknowledge it, so.
So, this is not going to be a popular answer. My background is in history. I love history in ways that I can't even get you to understand, right? But initially, my love of history was very Eurocentric, obviously, right? I'm educated in the United States. And so what I realized real quick is that, hey, I'm going to have to go all the way through 12, so if there are any high school history teachers in here, I'm sorry. But K-12 education is indoctrination, and it just makes you a good American, right? It just makes you a good, voting, patriotic American. Right, so then you graduate and you go to college and your brain explodes in the first semester because now you're introduced to some other things. And you're like angry for at least 2 years. So you now start to learn things that you could have handled in the sixth grade. You could have handled that truth, right? Our families were kind of telling us some of these things. And so for me, when I look at what the nature of education is, and of our public education system as it relates to this country, when I look at what the nature of that is, then I know what I can do for my family as somebody who knows some things, right? So what I have to say is that, yes, it absolutely indoctrinates us, and I don't see it stopping anytime soon.
There's no reason for it.
I just think that's honest. It's not going to stop anytime soon.
There's no reason.
But some one of the things that we learned that I didn't even learn until not college but grad school is how public education in this country started, how far it's veered from when it started. So public education paid by the state is a byproduct of free slaves coming into Reconstruction. That is a fact, right? The push for it, that's where it comes from. That's something I didn't even know until a few years ago, right? So to look at what it is now is problematic, but we also are in a point where we have more access to information than we ever have, ever, in our lives. Lay people have more access to information. And so I think a lot of what we need to pull through some of this indoctrination is more of cultural education outside of school. Because to think that, and I don't think we stop fighting. I don't think we stop fighting to have schools get more accurate histories. I don't think that's something we do. But I also think we gotta fight the demon on both sides. And I think that what we know and what we can give our children, not just the ones that come from us, but our communities, can also help in that.
But the way it's structured right now, that's exactly what it does. It makes you kind of really good, solid, God-fearing, flag-waving American. And it assimilates you, mm-hmm. right? You give up any, if it works effectively, you're just an American, right? Mm-hmm. So when you say that, well, why do we hyphenate? That's being ahistoric, right? Mm-hmm. So when I hear things like we're post-racial, or we're all human, or why don't we just call each other American? That's telling me that this kind of education system that we see as problematic is working, mm-hmm. right? Because that's what it's supposed to do, just lump us all into one thing. And I don't think the strength in America is that we're a melting pot. I think it's that we were kind of a salad, right? And that we had all these different perspectives, that if we listened to them, we could have been better. If we listened to these multiplicity of perspectives, but what we did was subsume them. Like, these got subsumed into white, and these got thrown into black, and then we put them at, we put it at war with each other. And I'm not, and you know, of course I say we lose people, but that's what happened. And I think, just to be very, if we're very clear about what we know, that the system is set up, the education system is set up to teach us, and we can work against it, but while also fighting it at the same time.
And one of the things I try to do is make some of that stuff accessible. I get a lot of emails and stuff from teachers where, like, I showed your video about XYZ in class. And so that's kind of like where I see my cog in, like, the activist machine of, like, I'm making accessible things, because they're not going to do it, you know? It would be great if they could say, let's teach the full truth, but they're probably not. But fortunately, there are some sneaky educators who are willing to say, hey, kids, let's watch this Cat Black video. You know, so there's hope.
And they're good jumping points. One of the things that I do, I probably shouldn't admit it, but one of the things that I do is there's an access to information issue. So we can get into the academy and we know so much, right? And you go home to your community and you're like, why don't you know these things, right? But you could introduce them to it, right? So the books that I have, the PDFs that I have, one of my favorite quotes is, if I have a PDF, you have a PDF. Mm-hmm. Now, I can't make you read it. But I'm a resource, right? I pride myself on being a resource. I was a resource before I came to college, and I'm a resource after. And that's something that we have to do. So regardless of kind of how you want your career to go, I'm not here to shame anybody for that, but regardless of how you want it to go, you have access to information that your communities, regardless of what those communities are, don't have access to. And you have to, I think, the least we can do is be a conduit for that, to relay that information back.
I have a 16-year-old daughter, and I had to start very early with her to proffer a different consciousness than the schools were going to give her even before she started school. And so one of the ways you educate is through art. The art in my house has her default image of God or Jesus as black. She can't imagine Jesus another color. She says when she sees a picture of white Jesus with blonde hair, who is that? But that's just one way in which I began very early to shape her mind. In first grade, I had to begin teaching her about racism, sexism, and heterosexism. And she gets it now. She gets it in a way that grown folks don't get it at 16. And I've hated having her in public school, but I've resisted charter schools as somewhat demonic. But public schools have their own demons too. They have this capacity for snuffing out every creative impulse in a child. They have the capacity to farm out things that should be standard part of your education, such as physical education. That's now farmed out to professionals that parents, of course, have to pay for. And music. Of course, now she's in a high school for the arts, and she's pursuing her. And so we have to privilege creativity in children every which way we can, every which way we can, and also help them to shape some consciousness about things. So I'm not sure what the answer is to the intransigence of the educational system. I don't see how they don't learn that what they're doing is not working. It's not working. We have a dropout rate that's abominable for young African American and Latino boys, for example. It's abominable, and we have children who lose hope that they're even going to survive past their 16th birthday. So I don't know what to say except that. In my own classroom, I teach adults, of course, because I teach in graduate school. But in my own classroom, I have to address the child that has been educated up through college, up to that point, because they have never been, never experienced any privileging of their own creativity, of their own views of the world, their own ways of seeing things. And so, I mean, that's something that I do, it's something that I promote, but I really can't say how then, except as I did for a couple of years. I was on the local school council because I needed to be involved in what's taught in my child's curriculum. And so, and maybe that's something you can do as you move through life and opt to be a public minister in that way. But there are many ways in which we begin now to teach our children that they're valuable and that they have a right to be and to become who they are, whatever that is.
I agree with everything, so I don't want to say too much more. So I think I've been to many, many, many schools. I've been doing youth programming since I was 15, so it's like 12 years now, and I've been to mostly schools in the Chicagoland area. And I agree that like schools are about indoctrination, right? And I think what's interesting to understand is like having visited dozens and dozens of schools throughout Cook County. The difference in like what indoctrination looks like depending on what race you are, right? Some people are indoctrinated into capitalism where it's like you will be a successful person, which means you will have this kind of job and it will be defined by how much money you have. And anything less than that, you're a failure. For some people, it means you will be indoctrinated to understand that you are nothing more than a criminal. And you will know that from the moment you walk in through metal detector doors to the moment you walk out and there are 8 police cars outside. To the moment when you're in your class and there are police officers in your classroom patrolling, right? Grabbing you by the head. So there's like that's indoctrination it's not equal. Right? We're all being indoctrinated, but not the same. So that's a problem. I'm a middle school teacher at an independent Afrocentric school. It's a weird private school that's funded through a daycare with almost all black students. And I love that job and I love. All of my students, they're brilliant. I am terrified for when they graduate and have to go to, they're all going to public CPS schools. And they're gonna be seen as failures because they have not been indoctrinated into that idea that they are, that their role in life is to hopefully just like barely make it, right? That's the best they can hope for. So what I think is important about education, like I think though that education, it can be liberatory. I think I believe in public education fiercely. I believe in education, and I think there are some things that are good to know, but like no one can know everything, and so immediately the moment that you create curriculum, there's power dynamics, and it tends to be adult versus young people. Another word that you should Google is adultism. It's real. Look it up. And for me as a teacher, I don't think my job, and I'm lucky to have a school that supports this, my job isn't to be like, you need to know these things. My job is to help you know what it is that you want to know about the world. So today, my lesson plan today was literally like, we're going to learn about the Zapatistas. Well, who are the Zapatistas? I don't really know that much about them. They're in Mexico. Let's find out. And all day, I taught them how I learn about things. And now all of us could give a 20-minute presentation about the Zapatista movement. And that's like a difference between like standardized, where you're just trying to dump knowledge into someone's brain, versus teaching people how to think and how to learn about the world around them. And then the next piece that's missing is how to change the world around them, to how to interact and engage the world around you, not just take it as what it is.
And I also want to point out, as I'm sitting here thinking about it, that this stuff is all systemic, right? And so depending on where you're located and where you go to school, education could have been attacked in the school that you're from. I'm from North Carolina, and it's pretty much attacked. But it's specific kinds of education. So, and I'm always willing to fight for a thing that somebody's trying to keep from me, right? So if somebody's actively trying to keep you from something, you probably need to know why. And so, for example, liberal arts education is under attack where I'm from. But who's been the thinkers, right? Who've been the people who can imagine another world? And so I think that I don't want to come off as my critique of what public education is set up to do for female teachers. They're operating within a very heavily structured system, right? And like Pat said, there are teachers who find ways to subvert it, right? Be those teachers. If you're going into education, be those teachers.
Do I need to stand and introduce myself?
Sure.
Okay. Hi, I'm Ryan. I'm a sophomore history major, education minor. And my question is regarding the Hotep movement. For those of you who don't know, they're a movement. They are very Egypto-centric, for lack of a better word. They maintain that, for example, homosexuality is a European disease. They're a big problem, especially for like the queer community, for mixed people like myself. My big question is, how do you propose that we address the Hotep subculture?
With love. With love. And respect that we all have a long way to go, right? I don't have much patience anymore for people who don't ask questions. That's real. But the things that I'm willing to go to jail for now, I was willing to cry and scream at you for 4 years ago. And we all have a long way to go. And Hotepness comes out of a love of blackness in a world that hates blackness, and a desire to be kings and queens, right? Even though that's problematic. And a fear of, and a exhaustion and rage at always being the other, right? And so adding more otherness, being like a woman black who's black or a queer person who's black, is we don't want to center that because we're trying to just be accepted. We're trying to just get into the box, right? And I'm not saying that's right, but I think we need to like try, rather than just like exiling people and disposing people and dismissing people, I think that mentality of like that anyone is disposable is as much a part of the problem as Hotep is, right? And that we need to figure out where is that coming from, and then ask questions that force people to recognize the contradictions in what they're saying. Because when you speak with love, and you approach things not trying to be right, but actually trying to get free, I think people recognize that. And I think people hear it. And I don't think they'll necessarily agree with you in that moment, in that conversation, but it'll stay with them. People like feel love and honesty and authenticity in ways that like can't be shook off and dismissed. And you don't ever know what that mini conversation and that refusal to just clash might lead that person to, especially if you leave it with a, you should read this book, or you should read this article. Because they won't read it in front of you, but they might read it in the ear. And I'm that person, right? I like am queer now, but was very homophobic growing up, right? And I had to go through years and years of people being patient and loving me.
So I think, for me, that question feeds very well into the question that came before it. Because I think a really Eurocentric education breeds Hotepness. Mm. And I can say that, and I'd love to say, but I can't speak for everybody, but I distinctly remember being a Hotep high priestess, okay? I distinctly remember being about 18, 19 years old, not homophobic, I wasn't homophobic, but I was very much like, whatever you need, brother, what do you need, right? He's angry, what can I do to make him less angry? Like, kings and queens and unks almost got tattooed on my arm, like, I was there, right? But I think that's a complete rejection of our Eurocentric education. So who I blame in the, first of all, like Paige said, the Hotep, I hate that that's the word we use, but I use it because you need to reclaim your word. Don't tell me not to use it. You need to reclaim your word for the good that it was. But it started out as very much, like a massive, I think,
reclamation of our history. The problem is when you're using that reclamation centers Egypt, I find that problematic. And also when that's a weapon against your own people, you can question feminism, but you're not questioning that you're using this history against your own people. So that's a problem. But the people that I have no patience for in that situation are the teachers, right? So I said I wasn't gonna call these names, but I'm gonna have to. So like Umar Johnson, some ways to Tariq Nasheed, Hidden Colors, and in the worst ways, Tommy Sotomayor. These three, if you look at the following, so you have a young man who's disenchanted with this Eurocentric education he got. He knows that he's on the bottom of so many different things, and he can't see that women are lording him. He knows that he's on the bottom of certain things. And this person is talking about recognizing his manhood. And this person is talking about recognizing that he's a king. And this person is talking about all these different things. And this person is also saying attack anything that calls him to question these things, right? There's, to me, that level of indoctrination from really, to me, very hateful people, very hateful men, breeds homophobia, right? It breeds homophobia in a way that I cannot ask a person who is queer to have tolerance for people that are effectively sometimes ushering your death, right? Yes. I can't do that. So the people that I'm mad at might not be the 19-year-old person that's hotel, but it would definitely be the adult that's like indoctrinating all these young men. And so that was another part. So for the paper I was telling you guys I wrote, that's how I opened it. I showed the following and reach of Umar Johnson, his Facebook, his Twitter, his YouTube, and the amount of people that he's able to reach, the number of followers. And then I showed some of his videos, right? And so if you can sit and watch those videos, grab you some popcorn and something to drink, and if you can sit from the first video to the last video and tell me that that man sounds like he loves you. So when you're hearing sound bites, it's easy to buy it. But if you watch it from beginning to end, if you look at every, the whole body of work, this man, this is not coming from a place of love. And so for me, I'm very angry at the teachers, the movers and shakers, and that kind of sub, not Hotep uses the greeting and love for black people, but we know what we mean when we say the subgroup. I'm very angry at the leaders in that situation. But what so I have a level of patience with young people that I don't have with older people still doing the same nonsense. But also, when you're at a point where what you're feeling is, so I tell people also talk to me in 5 years, right? Because I know what it was when I went through being in love with Egypt as if Africa stopped at that border. I remember what that felt like. I remember that it was necessary for my growth. But what it wasn't doing at the time, what I wasn't noticing, was like homophobia, transphobia. The sexism I noticed, and I'm like, but everything in our history teaches me to be supportive. Like, I don't know how else to be. But I didn't buy into those aspects, and I don't think they were as severe. I definitely agree with Paige that we should try to have dialogues, but when this person means you harm, and that happens, right? We gotta talk about that happens in those situations, and how when you talk to somebody who listens to one of the three people that I named, you know it. You know which one of the three they follow, because if somebody says hair hat, who are they following? Tommy Sotomayor, right? And so that my goal is to fight them. But to me, the young people, they're rejecting a Eurocentric education. Mm-hmm. That's at the center of all of it. And so we can fight them with knowledge. Sometimes, like she said, sometimes they might not read it in front of you or admit that they'll even listen, but sometimes they will, and most of us come out. Most of us go through the phase, and we can talk and laugh about it. Like, I almost got an tattoo on my arm. And like, you know what I mean? But at the end of the day, it's a rejection of a really jacked up education. But what I can't do, I don't know how to deal with having the patience for knowing that it's a rejection of a jacked up education system, and allowing homophobia and transphobia that is harmful to so many people in our community. I don't know how to balance those two.
And I believe that a posture of sacramentality, or love, as you put it, regarding everything in creation is potentially revealing something about the divine. Means that we learn from everybody, and we also define who we are, and we find our community, and we allow people to name themselves. You name yourself, and in defining yourself, you define yourself by who's included in your community. So the smaller the person, the smaller the circle. The smaller the circle, the smaller the person. So I would encourage you to expand your sense of who you can be in community with, and to regard others as those from whom you can learn very, very much.
We have time for one more question.
So something that I struggle with in class a lot is, and something that I struggle with just in my daily life, especially with my interactions on campus, is hearing problematic things. So someone who says something that reinforces rape culture or reinforces patriarchy or toxic masculinity, white supremacy, things like that, how do I check them? Right? So like, if they have this really negative outlook, how can I approach them, whether they're hostile towards my views or not, right? Like, how do I engage them in a productive discourse that might change their mind or at least plant that seed, like, hey, maybe what I said was problematic. Like, how can I effectively, even in the middle of class discussion, keep something grounded in the class discussion and still like have a productive discourse with them where I can check the problematic garbage that they said?
Well, I think that it's always really important to choose your battles. What I've learned is some people will never hear it no matter how you present it, and it's not always worth it. But in the case of like people making like a joke, for example, I would ask them, explain the joke to me. Like, okay, why is that funny? Because I think most people, if they break it down, they'll kind of start to be a little embarrassed. You kind of understand as you're explaining it that this is not funny. You know, the sexist joke you just made is not really funny. You know, so.
Come prepared with knowledge. That tends to shut people up.
Also be mindful that what I've noticed is that problematic people will band together when corrected in public spaces, right? So everybody in this room, like you could say something very problematic to me, and everybody could know that what you said was problematic. And depending on how I check you, men in the room will protect you. And they know that you were problematic, but they don't like that I checked you in that way, right? And so I agree with Kat. I want people to check it wherever it is, but I know that's not gonna work. Sometimes in spaces outside of that space might be the best place for you to come at other men, sometimes other black men. So like I said, look at the dynamics in class. There's two black men in class and y'all go at it in a fully white class. That might not be the best place to do that. And I'm not going to the age-old keep family business, blah, blah, blah. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying you want to be the most effective. And if I have to protect myself in this like all-white space or all-woman space or all-whatever space, and you're also coming at me, I might hear you if it was just us, right? Mm-hmm. But I probably might not hear you if I'm already protecting myself in that situation, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
So sometimes in terms of picking and choosing your battle, pick a location of your battle. That might help too.
Yeah, sometimes you'll hear, you know, a black person say something that is anti-black as hell. But if they're around a lot of white people and you check them, they've learned that there is, you know, very superficial privileges that come with siding with white supremacy. So siding with anti-blackness, it gets them the pat on the back. And within a white space, that's a more favorable position to be in. So you're the one who's the extremist, you're the one who is just, you know, you're the one who's in the wrong here, even though you know it's wrong, and he probably does know that it's wrong. But in that space, there's not going to be a productive conversation that's had. So yeah, choose your battle and the location. I think that's really important.
Yeah, I agree. Like I like making people feel uncomfortable, and so I think asking questions, exactly like what do you mean, right? That's usually all that I'll do. I'll tell a story. So this past weekend we were having this meeting to plan an action at a bar, and I got there early. Well, I got there like an hour late, and no one was there yet. That's some people. So I was there for a half hour before my people showed up. And there was this white woman with dreads at the table behind me, and I was just like, I got it. This comes up all the time. Like, I wish I had like a card that was just like, hey, like I don't have to say anything. I like I at this point have a temper and I'm just tired. Like I just the more I learn about the world, the more everything is it's just constant. Like and you can never like I just wish that I had blinders more than I want to like actually change this microaggression. I just wish that I didn't recognize it anymore, didn't see it. So I just like kind of want cards that I can give to people like, hey, this is what appropriation means. But I wait. So I wait and all my friends come and it's all black. We're all black. And after like an hour, we start going, no white dreads, no white dreads. They know that. They know. Really loud, really loud. So she heard it and it's making her uncomfortable. And I did that because I had my people and I knew I had my people. And then another half hour goes by and she's leaving. And I'm like, oh, I got this, y'all. And I get up because I know my squad is going to have my back. What was interesting is I'm actually, like, I'm very, when push comes to shove, like, I can be very diplomatic. And I was like, hey, like, I bet you heard, I want to, like, apologize if we were chanting at you, but also, like, I do kind of want to know, like, why you would have dreadlocks, right? And she's like, oh, I know, I've been thinking a lot about it, and I know it's, like, pretty problematic, but I'm really committed to the aesthetic. And my friends have locks, right? And, like, experience this bullshit that comes with that, right? And that's when Tess is standing on a table grabbing her hair. And it just was, like, a mess. And her friends came in, and I held her hands, and I was turning and I was like, you need to just walk away, because it is only going to get worse for you right now. We're going to win. So walk away and remember this moment. And I hope next time I see you, you don't have that shit on your head. And she left. And her friends, they were all so angry. So angry. So were we. And we but like I, for me, like what I that what for me, I did it because I felt powerful. And at the end of the day, we're never gonna end those if we don't organize. Like it's not enough to just have these little conversations. You have to organize. And you have to organize in ways that redistribute and build up alternative modes of power. And like if your only focus is handing out little business cards about what appropriation is, it's never gonna work. And so like that, I was in a 2-hour meeting organizing a thing to shut another thing down later this week, right? I felt powerful. We know how to manipulate that moment to make us the powerful people, right? In an all white bar, right? Where that's no one else is questioning it. And I think if you can do that, go for it. But it's most times, I see white people with dreads all the time from Vermont. I've never ever done that before.
Yeah, I just also, because white people with dreads is literally the most popular topic on my channel, I wanted to say, just because I thought of it, it's like sometimes you have to recognize that they're going to do it regardless, you know? Like, it's just kind of like a shitty thing to recognize. It's like, you know what? I've had this conversation so many times. I've heard about the Celtic origins of dreads.
They're not the same. They
and
aren't the
you know what? And how many times have I said, first of all, they did not have dreads. But you can only repeat yourself so many times. And one thing I've experienced just having that particular conversation specifically is you can exhaust yourself. I'm not saying to never call it out. You should. But it also recognize that, you know, like she said, there's always gonna be another person. There's always gonna be another person. So, you know, I personally, because I'm someone who's always constantly like calling this out, calling that out. Let's talk about this, let's talk about that. And dreads is like one of the biggest things I talked about. And it's just like, it's not always productive. It's not always gonna happen. But honestly, I had a friend of mine who was very socially aware, white queer person who, when I met them, had dreads. And through a lot of, you know, and I didn't necessarily say anything about it, even though it did bother me, but as they understood anti-blackness and appropriation, they cut that shit off. And so, while I'm also saying don't choose your battles, also recognize that there are some people that they'll get it eventually. They might start talking about, oh, you know, the sadhus in India, and but eventually, I think most people who are open to it will get it. And the thing is, there are some people who are, and there are some people who just are not. So, yeah.
I think a perfect example of, and I can't remember her name, but I know y'all have probably seen, there's a video going around of
Ellie Burch.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So this woman is talking about Beyonce's performance. won the Super Bowl, and then Charlamagne the God in the Breakfast Club made her Donkey of the Day, and then there's a conversation between the two of them. So in this conversation between the two of them, she has them on the show by video. Her eyes are completely dead, right? There is no comprehension happening. There is no listening happening. And at that point, I'm like, Charlamagne is like low-key a saint, because I would have stopped that conversation really early. There was nothing. And so you can tell, I think, most of us can tell when a person is listening to you and when a person is not. And there are too many people that really kind of actually want to get it to devote your time to the people who don't. And so, you know, if there are people that you feel like you have some kind of rapport for and you feel like they don't know, right? You feel like they're not an asshole, they just don't know, then take the time to educate them. But for the people who you're not going to get to them, I would not waste my time in that way.
Some people are not listening to you. They're thinking about their response. They have their response prepared. They've had this conversation with black people already who are apparently racist against them because they're white and they have dreads and they can't accept it. They, you know, it's not, you know, some people, it's just not going to go anywhere. And I trust, I've had so many of those conversations. That's why I started making videos about it. I got so tired of explaining myself over and over again to people who were committed to not listening. And honestly, I've had a lot of people who have watched my stuff, who have listened, who were open to listening, who have changed their ways. So, you know, there's productive conversations and there's conversations that will have no end. So, you know, the dead behind the eyes thing, I've experienced that so often. It's just they're not even interested. So, yeah.
Please give our guests a hand. Yourselves as you walk out of here, but also hopefully in our classrooms, over in the future, tomorrow, and so forth. Continue to ask questions, continue to open your mind, continue to talk to each other and to listen to each other, and also continue to thank Emmanuel for bringing in.
Thank you guys for coming out.
Good night. Thank you.